Hello, this is Dr. Carlo Ojer, emergency physician. In this short educational video, we're going to use the article published at Emergency Physician Monthly, which is titled Supplemental Oxygen Can Worsen Outcomes in STEMI Patients. And we're going to kind of summarize the main points of that article. Emergency clinicians rarely have to worry about oxygen toxicity, but perhaps they should. The picture above shows some of the symptoms of oxygen toxicity. It's ritual to use low flow oxygen for a variety of unproven conditions. It's omnipresent. We use it all the time in the emergency department, from belly pain to chest pain to lightheadedness to dizziness. And very few patients with chest pain, abdominal pain, or other multi-system issues can escape the oxygen emitting nasal cannula in the emergency department. It's just something we do all the time. It has become obvious over the years that high flow 100% oxygen for prolonged period of time can cause its own toxicity, with the lung being the main target of that toxicity. That's why oxygen concentration is weaned as soon as possible on ventilated patients in the ICU. And many are now even decreasing the use of high flow oxygen in other patients as well. We have known that in neonatal patients, it can contribute to damage in the brain, to problems with blindness. So we know that 100% oxygen for too long is bad. But how about not 100% oxygen? There's been a study. It's the AVOID trial, air versus oxygen in myocardial infarction study. An amazing and rather thought-provoking concept was presented at the recent American Heart Association Scientific Sessions 2014. Ahead of publications, including Medscape, detailed the results of the AVOID trial. This study compares supplemental oxygen with no oxygen in ST-SMN elevation of myocardial infarction, except for hypoxic patients who did receive oxygen, of course. Patients in the AVOID trial had oxygen saturation in a normal range defined as greater than 94% saturation by pulse oximetry. Patients had to have a diagnostic EKG demonstrating ST-segment elevation consistent with STEMI to be enrolled in the study. They were not included if their oxygen saturation was below 94%, if they had altered consciousness, or if they had already received oxygen prior to the randomization. Those with a confirmed STEMI received either room air or oxygen by mass at 8 liters per minute, given pre-hospital and continued until they were stable on the floor. Those with no oxygen arm were not given oxygen unless they became hypoxic, again, saturation less than 94%. The routine administration of prolonged high-flow oxygen to patients with normal oxygen saturations was indeed associated with an increase in recurrent myocardial infarction and major cardiac arrhythmias, and even greater infarct size at 6 months follow-up. These are rather startling observations, almost medical heresy. Supplemental oxygen has been fundamental to the management of patients with suspected acute ST-segment elevation MI for many years, and its routine administration is universal. But little evidence on its benefit has been found in randomized clinical trials. It only seems logical to put patients on oxygen because chest pain is thought to be because of the lack of oxygen flow to myocardial tissue. As little as 15 to 20 minutes of oxygen administration can cause hyperoxia, which actually leads to a reduction in coronary blood flow, increased coronary vascular resistance, and increased oxygen-free radicals, and adverse changes in cardiac microcirculation. Decrements in vital capacity of up to 20% have been noted in hyperoxic exposure. These changes, including by induced by oxygen, may contribute to increased reperfusion injury and actual new myocardial injury during acute coronary syndromes. Cardiac arrest and cardiogenic shock occurred similarly in both groups. One interesting fact was the use of oxygen showed no indication of symptomatic benefit, such as lessening the chest pain. The primary endpoint, myocardial infarction size based on enzyme elevation, and revealed a significant 25% increase in CK in those delivered oxygen, a clinical suggestion of increased myocardial injury. No significant change was noted in troponin levels. Cardiac MRI evaluating the infarct size at 6 months suggested an increased infarct size and more myocardial injury in those giving oxygen. The study also showed an overall trend towards harm for the oxygen arm. Mortality was similar in both groups, but a significant increase in the recurrent MIs, significant arrhythmias, was seen with the oxygen group. The authors emphasized that the patients were not hypoxic, and they said only those who had oxygen saturation less than 96% should not be given oxygen. So who would ever think that high-flow oxygen administered in patients in the throes of acute myocardial infarction would actually worsen outcomes, namely increased myocardial infarction size, increased arrhythmia, and increased rate of myocardial infarction? Not me, not the other 100 ER doctors I worked with in the past, nurses, etc. The outcome of this study, however, makes sense when one considers the effects of hyperoxygenation. Numerous detrimental effects are seen in high-dose oxygen on myocardial tissue and myocardial blood flow. So, in conclusion, very few articles, when I read them, make me rethink the way I treat my patients. Certainly makes me rethink the way I will treat all my patients with not hypoxic in the emergency department. Like I said initially, a lot of patients put on oxygen right when they get to the ER, whether they're hypoxic or not, whether it's chest pain or belly pain or just lightheadedness. How I change my practice. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. So unless they're hypoxic, defined as less than 96%, I am not going to give oxygen to my patients. If I was a patient, I wouldn't want it. And that's it. I hope you like this video. We'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Mr. Holmes has a bug crawling in his ear. He says he still feels it moving in there.